Thank you. And I invite President of Al-Sharq Forum and former Director General of Al Jazeera, Wadah Khanfar.
Friends, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for coming today. I thank Dr. Dawood Abdullah and Memo for hosting this gathering today. We were honored, both Al-Sharq Forum and Memo, to have Jamal. The last two contributions Jamal did were to Al-Sharq Forum conference in Istanbul, and then immediately after that to Middle East Monitor Conference in London. I have five messages today. The first is to his family, friends, to his fiancée, who is with us today. Your loss is great. The agony of following up the news daily of what happened to Jamal was unbearable. To follow up the shreds of news about what the murderers did to his body in the consulate of Saudi Arabia in Istanbul was not something that any child, any person would love to see, not for any other fellow human, also to his father, to someone he cares about. Jamal loved you. Few days before his murder, he spoke to me about his feeling towards his sons and daughters who were left behind in Saudi Arabia, about his family, about his hope of building a new family in Istanbul, the new marriage that he was planning for. I laughed with him here in London. I said to him, Jamal, it seems to me that you are 10 years younger than the time that I saw you before. He laughed. I said, this is a new love. It was a new love. He was preparing to get married. He was telling me about his flat that he owned in Istanbul, and the way that he's going to furnish it, and the way that eventually going to settle. He said, exile is not something easy. He said, when I wake up in the morning and find myself alone, I question myself and I say, why did I leave my homeland? Why did I leave my family and land? Is it worth it? He says, then later on I say, yes, it is worth it. I have a bigger mission. So I tell his children, his sons and daughters, that all of us are grieving with you. I tell his fiancée, who is sitting with us today, that all of us are Jamal's family and friends who will follow the ideals and carry the ideals that Jamal stood for. Some people, you don't have to build gilded statues and marble monuments for them to be remembered. Even maybe we might not have a grave for the body of Jamal. But I think in every heart, in every good heart in this planet, Jamal shall reside. And his memory shall continue. The second message is to his colleagues, especially journalists across the world. Thank you for this great and noble stance that you took about Jamal. I am proud as a journalist to belong to this global family that decided not to allow this murder to go unpunished. A lot of cover-up was meant to end it and to classify it as a mystery or enigma or something that the future and history will tell about it. The President of the United States, he suggested the idea of the rogue elements trying to save his friend in Saudi Arabia. But you, journalists, across the world, decided that enough is enough. This is the tipping point of keeping silent to the atrocities and the crimes that these regimes in our land are committing day and night. And thank you for that, because you have put the issue of Jamal as a headline globally in 5 continents. And I think that will never be forgotten. It will be a landmark in the history of journalism. It will be a bright moment when the solidarity of journalists across the world stood up together in order to fight this cause. And believe me, continue the fight. I start sometimes hearing the statements about the issue of the mystery of Jamal's killing. There is nothing mysterious about it. It is the most clear crime committed ever. We know where it has been done. We know who did it. We know what time. We know what happened. We know everything. What is mysterious about it? People are trying to drag this process forward and forward in order to make it go away with time. We shall never allow Jamal murder to go unpunished. The third message is to the Arab world, to the Arab nations. We have been going through the last few years with extreme, brutal, dark moments in our history. We have lost the greatest hope that our generation and Jamal generation had of democracy and the freedom through the Arab Spring. It was murdered by the same people who murdered Jamal. And they murdered Jamal because they saw in him the light that created the Arab Spring. You should remember that Jamal was banned from tweeting and writing articles while he is in Saudi Arabia because he stood for the Arab Spring. He condemned the counter-revolutions that happened in our land. And he continued to write about those who are oppressed, thousands of them, the freedom fighters and the great young people who are in jails of Egypt, and those who have been murdered in Syria, and those who are being killed in Yemen, and those who have been silenced in his homeland in Saudi Arabia. Jamal was doing all of that on our behalf. And I feel that at least our generation can tell the next generation that Jamal Khashoggi belonged to us. We were not only those who failed to establish democracy in the Arab world, who failed to stand against oppression and dictators, but also some of us paid heavy price for the ideals, and Jamal was one of them. I tell those young people in the Arab world, Jamal could have the opportunity to live very comfortably in Saudi Arabia, could have accepted to be an advisor to the regime there, could have had the most comfortable life, but he gave up all of that, and he chose to live the free, and we should choose the same in order to liberate our territories and to find for our nations a place amongst the nations of the world. And the third message is to those who murdered Jamal. I remember, and you do, when Muammar al-Qaddafi, the dictator of Libya, was dragged to be killed by the young revolutionaries, he was shouting and screaming, "Who are you? I know that you don't see us. You don't see the people. You are obsessed by your power, your wealth, your friends in Washington, your friends in the corporations across the world, and the fact that you can bribe them, and they will accept the bribe because they don't see us as well. But I tell you, the ones who will draw the future are the young people who you don't see. And the day will come when you will realize that, but it will be too late. The murderers of Jamal Khashoggi did it in a way where it tells you a lot. They don't care. They know they are protected. They know they can handle it. They were surprised to find people across the world standing up for someone like him in journalism, in civil society, great humans in all over the world. But of course, they know that they can buy their way forward through bribing those who are in power and those who are in business. But believe me, that will never survive. And this is not going to happen. I see in the eyes of young people in the Arab world, in the cities and towns, in the countryside, in the villages, in the refugee camps of Syria and Yemen and Libya and Tunisia and Morocco and Palestine and Jordan and Iraq, everywhere, I see that Jamal is becoming the hero. He is the one who is introducing the new era of resistance and continuity, not for violence. Jamal was not a violent man. Jamal didn't want to be called an opposition because he understood that a great journalist is not the one who takes a side or ideology. A great journalist is the one that stands for truth. We know that Jamal stands for democracy. We will continue the fight for democracy in order to replace the mentality of those who chop the heads of people, not only extremists, but also people in palaces who are doing the same. We will never allow that to happen. We shall never, as Arabs, accept that we go through the dark ages. Hundreds of years, people in Europe refuse to live under, and they now ask us to accommodate that. This shall never happen. They have violated the sanctity of one of the most important and beautiful cities in the Sharq, Istanbul, because a lot of people in Istanbul are continuing to do something. They found refuge there. The Tunisians, the Syrians, the Iraqis, the Libyans, living in Istanbul in order to resume their dream. And they are chasing them up to that beautiful city. That shall never be forgotten. They will realize one day who the people are, and they will pay the heavy price for that. The last message, the fifth message, is to Jamal. When we met here in Istanbul, in London, we spoke about his experience, how difficult for him as a human being at the age of 60 to find himself exiled. And I saw the tears in his eyes speaking to me about his homeland, his family, and his town, Medina, which he loved very much. And I was telling him, jokingly, I'm a Palestinian, I'm used to exile. You are new to it. He laughed. He said, yeah, but I have a lot to learn from you. I said, you know, the most important thing is to keep fighting for a mission. At least we forget. I told him maybe the time has come for us to regard the mission as our homeland, not the land that we stand on. I have never imagined the evil in the regime that led to the murder of Jamal Khashoggi. He never even imagined that. You know why? Because he had a great heart. And a great heart like his cannot even envisage the level of evil that this regime could conduct. So my friend, my colleague Jamal, you have left us. But today, all of us are carrying your ideals and going to fight for it. You were great alive, and you are great dead. You shall continue always to be amongst us. Your spirit, your ideas, your thoughts, your values will continue to empower us. When any one of us feels weak in this battle for democracy and freedom and equality, we shall always remember you so we may resume our fight. We can never feel tired and exhausted after this. What a heavy burden on us your death is. How can we rest? How can we live comfortably after you? We can't. We shall never betray what you have stood for. I will say the following words in the language that he understood very much. He loved, he appreciated, he wrote in Arabic. أخي جمال سلام عليك يا ابن مدينة رسول الله حزنت على فراق المدينة كنت تقول أن أكثر ما يؤلمك ابتعادك عنها اليوم أقول لك مكة والمدينة تدعوان لك حواضر الشرقي ومعها عواصم الغرب تلهج بالثناء عليك أحببت أن يكون مدفنك في البقيع أحببت أن يكون مدفنك في البقيع فصار لك في كل قلب طاهر مقام ومنزل أحببت أن يكون مدفنك في البقيع فصار لك في كل قلب طاهر مقام ومنزل يا ابن الحجاز لقد رفع الله ذكرك لقد رفع الله قدرك فهذه القدس والشام بغداد والقاهرة تونس والرباط الدوحة وصنعاء حواضرنا وبوادينا وأريافنا تفخر بك سبحان من أعزك وأذل قاتليك تبت أيديهم إذ يقطعون جسدك وخابت أحلامهم أن يقطعوا ذكرك ستبقى في عيون الثائرين وأذكار الصالحين وأشعار العاشقين وفي آمال الساعين لفجر جديد أرادوا أن يمحوا من الوجود أثرك فصرت كالهواء والضياء تغذي آمالنا بأن الخير يسكن المستقبل سلام عليك يا سيد شهداء القلم سلام عليك يا ابن مدينة رسول الله Thank you.